Hey folks, this is Riker with a Diablo 3 patch 2.6.8 season 20 guide video. In this video, we'll cover some ways in which you can use the season 20 theme to your advantage. This season's theme is based entirely around the cube. Now normally, within your three cube slots, you can put one weapon, one armor, and one piece of jewelry. With the season 20 theme, you can assign any type of gear to any slot. It could be three weapons, it can be three pieces of jewelry, it can be three pieces of armor. So in this video, we're going to cover a few builds and discuss how those builds could be changed thanks to the Season 20 buff. I encourage you folks to sound off in the comments below with your ideas, and if you want to skip ahead, I'll put some timestamps in the video description below. So first off, Witch Doctors. The new Witch Doctor set, Mundunugus, is looking to be the top build of Season 20. But really, any Witch Doctor build that uses the Ring of Emptiness can benefit from this. The Ring of Emptiness, now changed for this latest patch, makes you deal more damage to enemies who are affected by either your Haunt or your Locust Swarm. Now, the Wormwood Staff gives you a passive Locust Swarm cast happening on a nearby enemy every second. So by putting this in your cube, you can free up one of your active skill slots and not have to cast Locust Swarm at all. Now in this example here, we're gonna take out the Ring of Royal Grandeur and we're gonna pop in a Wormwood. This allows us to remove Locust Swarm from our active slots and we can sub in something like Horrify Frightening Aspect. This allows us to add a pretty good defensive buff, 50% additional armor for 8 seconds after casting Horrify. And we don't have to deal with the micromanagement of casting Locust Swarm or the huge mana cost that comes with it. Now, losing the Ring of Royal Grandeur would mean that you cannot equip Captain Crimson's. So we're gonna go full 6-piece Mundunugu and slap a Belt of Transcendence on. Yes, this does mean we'll be dealing less damage with this variant, but this should overall make this build easier to play and tougher, because with the Belt of Transcendence, we're going to be summoning a bunch of fetishes, they will run interference, they will take damage for us, they will tank hits for us, and you don't have to fuss about micromanaging your Locust Swarm. Onto the Demon Hunter. Rapid fire builds, be it Natalia's or Legacy of Dreams, can benefit from more damage by introducing an Echoing Fury into the cube. This would, however, have to come at the cost of damage mitigation. Whether you have an Aquila Cuirass in your cube or Stone Gauntlets, you'll have to forfeit those for the Echoing Fury. We're gonna lose toughness, but we're gonna gain a whole lot of attack speed. And another Demon Hunter build that can benefit from Season 20 is the N6M4 build. That 6-piece Natalia, 4-piece Marauder can now squeeze into the cube a Yang's Recurve and a Dead Man's Legacy while also having a Bombardier's Rucksack equipped. This allows us to run a multi-shot N6M4 build. This serves as a huge damage multiplier and in fact a tremendous damage buff for the N6M4 build, while also changing it from a historically cluster arrow based build into now a multi-shot based build, given we can stack these two damage items. Onto the Crusader. At the cost of the toughness granted by its armor slot, the Crusader could go for even more damage by working a total of 3 shields into this build. Of course you want to be equipping Akrat's Awakening, but apart from that, you can have the Ivory Tower, the Shield of Fury, and Akrat's Awakening all equipped. With Ivory Tower, your blocks release forward a Fires of Heaven. This means you want to build towards block chance. The more often you block, the more often you're releasing Fires of Heaven, which is a rune on Heaven's Fury. The Shield of Fury makes enemies take more damage the more they're hit by your Heaven's Fury. And then Akrat's Awakening basically gives you cooldown reduction every time you block an attack, synergizing well with your desire to increase your block chance. This should also make up for the loss of the Aquila Cuirass by allowing us to have permanent uptime on Akrat's champion. Next, onto Wizard. The new Legacy of Dreams Hydra Wizard can benefit from the Season 20 buff. As an option in the cube, in the armor slot, we can instead take an Orb of Infinite Depth. Every time we hit an enemy with Explosive Blast, we're gonna increase our damage by 10% and our damage reduction for 20%, and this can stack up to 4 times, giving us a bunch more damage and a bunch more damage reduction. In this case, we would obviously need to work Explosive Blast into the build. And in doing so, we'll remove Teleport, costing us our mobility. Onto Barbarian. Let's take a look at the Whirlrend Barbarian. Now, as long as we're using Captain Crimson's, there's not much we can do. But if we opt to run without Captain Crimson's, then we can instead equip the Lamentation Belt, which frees up our armor slot to equip an Echoing Fury to squeeze out more damage and more speed. In addition, by re-equipping the Waste's Pants, we free up the shoulder slot to equip a Mantle of Channeling for a bit more damage and a bit more damage reduction while channeling Whirlwind. Alternatively, we could equip Focus and Restraint for a big damage multiplier, in which case in our cube we'll want to have the Obsidian Ring of the Zodiac and the Convention of Elements while still maintaining that Flavor of Time equipped in our amulet slot. Now if we do this, we'll need to add a generator to this build. I would suggest swapping out Ancient Spear for Furious Charge, Merciless Assault. Another Barbarian build that could benefit from the Season 20 bonus would be the Frenzy Barb, transforming the Greater Rift pushing build into a speed farming build for T16 Rifts. In this case, we would drop our Band of Might entirely and substitute in an Echoing Fury instead for more attack speed and move speed. We would also drop our main hand weapon, and then the two weapons we'd want to have equipped would be an Oathkeeper and an Ingham. The Ingham will give us massive cooldown when we kill an Elite Pack, and because of that we'll swap out our Mortix Brace Bracers for Nemesis Bracers to spawn more Elite Packs. This will help us maintain more uptime on our Wrath of the Berserker. We won't need the extra damage from our Depth Diggers, so instead we'll swap in a Gold Wrap. This, combined with an Avarice Band and a Boon of the Hoarder gem, will give us all the toughness that we'll need. We'll be dropping our Traveler's Pledge and Compass Rose in order to benefit from this, so we'll instead take a Flavor of Time amulet. We'll swap out our Convention of Elements for Rachel's Ring of Larceny. This gives us move speed whenever we impose fear on an enemy. And so we're going to change the rune on our Threatening Shout to Terrify in order to impose fear on enemies. Onto the Monk. The Justice Monk gets a nice buff here. The Wam Kim Lao can now be placed into the cube, replacing the Mantle of Channeling. And instead, you can equip the Little Rogue and Slanderer. This'll net you a lot more damage and an alternate source of toughness to the Mantle of Channeling. Onto the Necromancer. The Thorns Necro took a heavy hit. It went from being one of the best builds in the game to a, let's call it, mediocre build. Thankfully, it's able to benefit quite significantly from the Season 20 buff. The armor slot previously was not giving this build any tremendous buff in power, but now we can work into that either a Furnace or Rylina's Shadow Hook for a damage buff. A Furnace will give us 50% more damage versus elites, but ideally you'd want to go with a Rylina's Shadow Hook, stack as much essence as you can on your gear, and benefit from 165% increased damage to all targets. Now there is one entirely new build that is facilitated and enabled only thanks to the Season 20 theme. In other words, this build will only exist throughout Season 20, and it will arguably be the most powerful group build. This is a Legacy of Dreams Death Nova Necromancer, and it manages to equip and benefit from four different weapons. First, there's the Scythe of the Cycle, which you'll either want to equip or put in your cube, which gives you a huge damage multiplier on your secondary skills, of which Death Nova is one. The other one-handed scythe we want to take is Tragul's Corroded Fang. One of these two goes into the cube, the other one is equipped. Tragul's Corroded Fang makes the Cursed Scythe rune for Grim Scythe always apply a curse to an enemy, and adds a huge damage multiplier versus cursed enemies. Then the other two weapons we want to equip in our cube include the Blood Tide Blade, which gives us a huge damage multiplier to our Death Nova, and Nair's Black Death, which makes each different poison skill you use increase the damage of your poison skills by a significant multiplier. So basically, this build revolves around stacking a bunch of different poison skill multipliers in order to turbocharge our Death Nova using the Blight Rune, which is the poison rune. Now this build really is designed to operate in groups. It suffers against single target. It's designed to do the area damage in a group composition, and the group will still need a different character for single target damage versus the Rift Guardian. This build also relies on other characters to be grouping and crowd controlling enemies, and additionally to simply keep it alive. The skills we take here are all designed towards building up as many poison stacks as possible. Grim Scythe, Cursed Scythe, which also pairs with our Tri-Ghouls, Bone Spikes, Bone Pillars, Bone Spear, Blighted Marrow, Command Skeletons, Kill Command, and even Bone Armor, Dislocation. And that's gonna wrap up this video, but again, I encourage you folks to post in the comments and upvote other people's suggestions on ways to use the Season 20 buff. As always, stay tuned for more Diablo 3 guides. Thanks for watching. Special thanks to my Twitch, Patreon, and YouTube supporters for making these videos possible. If you like what you see on this channel and want to support the creation of more content, you can consider pledging on YouTube or Patreon and unlocking behind-the-scenes content, monthly virtual hangouts, and more. If you enjoyed this video, please share it, check out these other videos, and subscribe to join Riker's Raiders for more Diablo content.